Well, good morning, Queensland. I can report that we've had 15,122 new cases reported in the last 24 hours. 4,575 of those were self-registered rapid antigen tests. And thank you to Queenslanders for continuing to register their positive results from their tests at home. I do have to report we have changed our active cases reporting. We have done a data cleansing because previously with active cases, it was very easy to track in Queensland because they're all in hospitals. But now we've got a lot of active cases in the community. We've gone through and applied the definition that all of the states and territories are using, which is the 7-day rule around what is an active case, which means that we have 86,953 active cases in Queensland. Of course, we know that's just those people who have come forward and got tested, and we are very confident that there's many other people out in the community who we haven't had tested at this stage but are seeing symptoms. Sadly, I report 7 deaths overnight, and again, our condolences to the family and friends of those 7 individuals. I'll let the Chief Health Officer go through the details of those individuals, but I will say this. None of those people had had their booster shot. They were all elderly people. And if I can encourage Queenslanders out there to do anything today, that is get yourself a booster shot. If someone you know who is eligible for a booster shot hasn't got it yet, please encourage them to come forward, and either a public vaccination centre or a pharmacy or a GP. We know the difference that a booster makes. And in fact, the Chief Health Officer will talk about some of those statistics today. It is so important people get their booster shot. But also we know there's people due for their second dose and also people who have not got vaccinated yet. We want them to come forward. We did 30,963 tests in the last 24 hours. And we've had 702 patients in hospitals currently, 47 in ICU, and 15 of those 47 are ventilated currently. So quite a jump, over 50 additional people in our hospitals, in our public hospitals, in the last 24 hours. But thankfully, we don't see the corresponding increase in ICU. But we want the least amount of people needing to be hospitalised, and that comes down to getting your vaccination and your booster shot. We are now at 91.59% first doses in Queensland and 88.71% second dose, which is fantastic. Boosters, we've done 954,998 boosters in Queensland now. And the 5 to 11 year olds, 12.82% are already vaccinated. This is extraordinary. It is 1 week to the day since we started the vaccination for 5 to 11-year-olds, and it is almost 13% of all of those children are already vaccinated. Thank you to the mums and dads and carers, grandparents out there who have brought the little ones forward to get vaccinated. It's been wonderful to go around to many of these vaccination clinics and meet some of these young kids and their parents, and I just am so grateful for them coming forward and getting vaccinated. And of course, we have Minister Grace here today to talk a little bit more about education and COVID and going forward. So the only other message here is one more LGA. Pumperow has shown their first positive case, which means there's one local government authority in Queensland that has not reported a positive case since the wave started on the 13th of December, and that's Boulia. But this now means it's everywhere in Queensland. And so do not assume that you can escape this virus. Get vaccinated. Make sure you're following the rules, wearing your mask, social distance, good hygiene, and of course, if you have any symptoms, testing, either a PCR or a home test, and staying home if you have any symptoms whatsoever. And thank everyone who are isolating and quarantine and doing the right thing, because that helps reduce the spread to your workplace, to your friends, and to your family and loved ones as well. The last thing I do want to say is 000 are still recording people ringing up simply to ask where they can go get a RAT or a PCR test and where the fever clinics are. This is not a reason to ring 000. So please make sure you are freeing up those lines for people who have emergencies and life-threatening conditions. Do not ring 000. You can ring 13 Health or 134 COVID if you want that information. All that information is also available on our social media and our website. So please do not take up 000 resources to simply ring up to where to get a test. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. So we have seven deaths to report today, two people in their 80s and five in their 90s. Two of these people had not been vaccinated, five were double vaxxed, and none had received a booster. Our thoughts are with their families today. In terms of the hospital situation, we now have 702 people in hospital, which is up from 670 for the preceding 24 hours. So that's a significant rise in the 24 hours leading up to 7 p.m. last night. Again, particularly centred on the Gold Coast and to a slightly lesser extent, Brisbane south of the river. So we are expecting Gold Coast to peak sometime in the next week or so, and Brisbane will follow shortly thereafter. So looking at what happens at the Gold Coast, we'll be able to predict to some extent what is going to happen in Brisbane a few days later. I've just got some interesting facts. I've previously mentioned that if you are unvaccinated, you are 9 times more likely to end up in hospital than someone who is triple vaxxed. So I've previously mentioned this, if you are unvaccinated in Queensland, you are 9 times more likely to end up in hospital than someone who is triple vaxxed. Now our statisticians have been busy at work looking at the intensive care units, and what they've found that if you are unvaccinated in Queensland, you are 24 times more likely to be admitted to a Queensland intensive care unit than someone who is triple vaxxed. So I'll say that extraordinary statistic again. If you are unvaccinated in Queensland, you are 24 times more likely to end up in an intensive care unit than someone who is triple vaccinated. I'm very pleased to see that almost 1 million Queenslanders have received their third dose of vaccine. That's fantastic. I am still very concerned that there are vulnerable people, elderly people, who have not received their third dose of vaccine, who might have received the second dose of the initial course many months ago, is what we're finding. They're people that are often ending up in intensive care or dying. So they've received their second dose many months ago, like the beginning of last year. And we know that the immunity wanes, particularly in those, the elderly and those who are immunosuppressed. So I'm particularly keen that the elderly and anyone who's immunosuppressed get that third dose to prevent them ending up in hospital or intensive care. But of course, anybody for whom it has been more than 4 months since that second dose of vaccine should go along and get their booster from their GP, from a pharmacy, or one of the Queensland health sites. I'll now hand over to the Education Minister.
Thank you, Dr. Gerard, and good morning, everyone, in particular our Facebook followers. First of all, I want to say a absolutely huge thank you to our Queensland students, principals, teachers and school staff, parents and carers, in fact, our entire school community, for their flexibility and resilience throughout these challenging times. We've had very positive responses to the announcement that the start of the 2022 school year in Queensland will move from January 24 to February 7, and obviously with remote learning for years 11 and 12 from Monday the 31st of January. This common sense measure is to avoid opening schools during the predicted peak of the Queensland Omicron variant and the wave, and allow more time for children to receive their COVID-19 vaccinations. And it's great to know that the best way to protect yourself is to get the jab, and the figures that the Health Minister gave this morning is truly wonderful. A brilliant uptake from our 5 to 11 year olds during the first week that they've been able to get vaccinated. And a big thank you to the parents and carers that have brought those young students out. And it's been wonderful to catch up with some of them as well. And I believe that a lot of them have been very brave, and we want to thank them wholeheartedly. Those numbers are very encouraging. With the delay to the start of the school, it is important that student learning isn't impacted. That's why we flagged an extra week at the end of term, at the end of the year. I wish to advise that after some very constructive, helpful and productive meetings with the Queensland Teachers Union, unions and key stakeholders, I am satisfied that the full curriculum can now be delivered in the condensed semester. That's over the next 2 terms. This means that the proposed extra week at the end of the school year will not be required. Can I repeat? It will now not be required, and the year will finish as planned on December the 9th, 22. Queensland has some of the best principals and teachers and staff in the country. They are highly skilled at delivering the curriculum across the school year, and students will not miss out. Can I assure parents and carers that they will not miss out on any essential content due to the delay now in the start of the term? They have done a magnificent job in rising to meet the needs of our students, and we are working on finalising a statement of agreement that the curriculum will be fully rolled out over the next semester, and I know that they will do a fantastic job in these uncertain times. I want to thank principals in particular. They have been absolutely wonderful in preparing schools for remote learning and the start of school. Teachers, teacher aides and all staff have done an incredible job, and they will continue to do so in what we know are very uncertain times. Can I remind parents and carers that while full remote learning will be in place for years 11 and 12, there are excellent resources for all students available on our website at our Learning at Home site. As I've said, our entire school communities, from students to principals and teachers and all staff, have shown incredible resilience throughout this pandemic. I want to thank them for that, and I am sure that they will continue to do so and ensure that students' learning will not be impacted by the delay to the start of school to the 7th of February this year. Can I also say that under the health advice that we are working nationally on a consistent set of guidelines on dealing with COVID in schools when schools do resume, and I look forward to working with Dr. Gerard and of course through National Cabinet on national consistent guidelines. So thank you very much.